So, on the one side, it manufactures young people to be quite useless to society, who are more active of themselves than the society. Very dangerous. And it also prepares the old people to dread old age and live as corpses for 10 or 15 years without any vital incentive to live. This is one of the glaring examples of not having the knowledge of seventh ray activity. Had the present mankind had the wisdom of the seventh ray activity properly, there would not have been a necessity of old people's houses built separately. For example, in the races that have a tradition from old nations, we have no necessity of old people's houses. For example, in India, we have no old people's houses till now. Automatically, the grandfathers serve the role of gurus to the grandsons. It was like that in many nations. But gradually, the Western civilization has killed that tendency till now. And in India also, it is being gradually killed. Once again, it is our duty to see old people after retirement were invited there into those schools, and they used to train the little children in the little schools conducted in those hermitages, and they invented many wonderful methods. For example, if they teach a lesson to a group of students, they engaged each student to teach the same lesson to their younger batch in the form of discussions and seminars. This is a healthy blend of the activity of the first ray and the seventh ray. Like this, by application and example, we can better understand the race. An intellectual approach to understand the race is more useless than useful, because for the simple reason that intelligence is different from knowledge. Intelligence is one of the instruments we have. Knowledge is the material which is to be exposed to the instrument. If you take the example of a cassette of tape, the cassette can be compared with intelligence because it has the potentiality to record. So the intelligence is your potentiality, whereas the discourse that is recorded upon the cassette can be called knowledge. So every one of us has a cassette with us, and we are expected to expose the cassette to some discourse which is positive and useful. And that discourse is what we have made an attempt now. When 10 or 20 or 30 or 40 of us gather together, then the change that has taken place in us during this process, closer approach to the terms. Automatically, it includes the activity of the first ray, because we are making an active attempt, which is different from individual reading. Individual reading only tackles intelligence, and there is no proper exposure of intelligence to knowledge. For example, if we try to read a book like one of the series of the seven rays alone and silently, and make a reflections of our own upon each sentence, the attempt is sincere and earnest, no doubt, but the time and the energy utilized is most uneconomical. because it is a sheer waste of human energy and time. It is like exposing the cassette, and the cassette is moving, and only very few messages are recorded on it. There will be much interval between one message and another message. And the portion of the empty cassette is much more than the portion of the messages on the cassette. So, that is what happens when we apply only the third ray activity. We are exposing the book only to our third ray activity. Remember that the first three rays are foremost, and the absence of any one of these rays in any good activity leaves our attempt deficient in some direction. So every good attempt should include the first three rays activity. No doubt, all the seven rays are equally important, just as all the parts of the body are equally important. But the head and the heart are more important than the other parts. That's the reason why the Shambhala center and the hierarchy center are more important. I wish to mention here that there is a science in the ancient scriptures and the ancient gurus of wisdom, which is called the science of superimposition. It is a very strange science, and it unlocks many secrets of ancient wisdom. According to that wisdom, the head and the spinal column of the human being is superimposed upon the axis of the earth. To find the correspondences between the axis of the earth and the cerebrospinal system, the student is expected to meditate every day for at least 15 minutes. The North Pole in his head and the South Pole in his base center, and the axis of rotation of the earth in the vertebral column, and the glaciers of the North Pole in the cortex tissue of his brain cells, brain tissue. This establishes a contact between the centers of his vehicle and the corresponding centers of the planet. That is the planet Earth. Consequently, the Shambhala center in the individual and the hierarchy center in the individual come into contact with the geographical Shambhala center and the geographical hierarchy center. This is how the ancient masters of wisdom discovered that there exists on this geographical earth a region called Shambhala, and they developed its archetypal symbolism. For example, if you go into the scriptures, Shambhala, to frame the administrative constitution of the indicate. Now, coming to the present point, there is no practical use of any good attempt unless we make a conscious application of the first three rays simultaneously. For example, I told you, if we make the application of the third ray only in a unilateral manner, by having a complete set of Alice A. Bueli's books in our personal library and keep a room separate for ourselves for the library, allow no one into the room, and keep the room pure and in perfect order, and open each book, sit down and read, pondering on each sentence separately, it is foolish, because the books find their way according to the need of mankind. In the book, if you fail to assimilate,